Good morning.
Good morning.
My name is Ariel Mink, and I am the State Clerk of the Presbytery of the Redwoods. And I was honored to be able to worship with you a few weeks ago. So some of you I have met, some of you I have not met, but I am always delighted to engage with you. So remind me of your names. If I met you a couple weeks ago, please remind me of your names. Are there other new folks here this morning that would like to be introduced? So I'm not the only one. Anyone new? Anyone new? Okay, good. Well, I think everybody knows that Cornelia and Carl are on vacation for the next few weeks. And so we wish them well. We'll lift them up in prayer. There are a couple adjustments in the order of worship that we'll make, and I'll announce those as we go along, just so that you're aware. We'll include the Lord's Prayer that isn't in there right now. We will be having time afterwards for some refreshment. Are there any other announcements that we need to lift up to the congregation today? No announcements? All right. Well, then let us go ahead and begin our worship together. Our help is in the name of the Lord.
Maker of heaven and earth.
Thank you.
invite you to be still, to quiet your hearts, and to join me in a prayer of confession. Lord God of all creation, we come to you from our storm-tossed lives to seek your peace. We come to you with our questions and uncertainties, our worries and anxieties. We have not sought out a word or wisdom. We have not shown any compassion or mercy when we should have. We have not loved our neighbor as we love ourselves. We have remained silent when we should have spoken, and spoken when we should have silent. Forgive us, God of hope. Remind us that if we but open our hearts, you will heal us. If we but listen to your words, we will hear peace and joy. If we but open our lives to you, we can go forth to serve our sisters and brothers, even as we have served by you, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. With calming words, with a peaceful spirit, with overflowing love and hope, our God forgives us and fills us with faith. Our God affirms us for who we are, those whose brokenness is made whole, those whose sin is forgiven, those whose lives overflow with faith. Thanks be to God.
Amen.
It's page 487 in your pew Bible if you want to follow along. Thanksgiving for deliverance from many troubles. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Those he redeemed from trouble and gathered in from the lands, from the east and from the west, and from the north and from the south. Some went down to the sea in ships, doing business on the mighty waters. They saw the deeds of the Lord, his wondrous works in the deep. For he commanded and raised the stormy wind, which lifted up the waves of the sea. They mounted up to heaven, and they went down to the depths. Their courage melted away in their calamity. They reeled and staggered like drunkards and were at their wits' end. Then they cried to the Lord in their trouble, and he brought them out from their disaster. He made the storm be still, and the waves of the sea were hushed. Then they were glad because they had quiet, and he brought them to their desired haven. Let them thank the Lord for his steadfast love and for his wonderful works to humankind. Let them extol him in the congregation of the people and praise him in the assembly of the elders. Here ends the reading.
Guess what? My name is Ariel. Do you guys watch Disney movies? Do you know the Little Mermaid Ariel? That's my name. Isn't that weird? Yeah, it's kind of weird, right? Well, how old are you?
Six.
And how old are you?
He's two. I'm about to be three.
Oh, my birthday is in July. My birthday's in July. When's your birthday?
August 5th.
When's the July birthday, do you know?
27th.
All right. Well, wonderful. Happy birthday. A little early, you guys.
It's
coming up close. It feels like it should be tomorrow, though, doesn't it?
Well, we are in July.
I know. It's hard to wait that long for birthdays. I know. Because guess what? My daughter is born on the same day as my birthday. So now we have to celebrate her birthday instead of my birthday, and that bums me out. So I get it. Well, guess what? Today, we're going to talk about when I was almost your age, just a little older, when I was 8 years old. Now, I'm going to guess you don't know how to water ski, but do you? Let me just ask, do you know how to water ski? No? I didn't know how to water ski either. And so my dad decided it was time to teach me how to water ski. So we went out, and I was about 8 or 9 years old, and he showed me how I was supposed to stand up on these little tiny skis. You think so? Yeah?
He knows how to ride a balance bike.
Well, that's good, because you have to balance on a balance bike just like you balance on water skis. And so you have to hold this little metal rod, sort of like you hold a steering wheel for your bicycle, and you lean back on your heels just like that in the water. And it's hard. So I was doing that, and the boat started, and all of a sudden, I fell off of my water skis. Now, what's supposed to happen is you're supposed to let go of the little rope that's towing you behind the boat.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Now I remember
what
water ski is.
Yes, I'm glad. So you remember? So Jesus got up, and he made all of the waves stop. Sort of like how my dad made the waves stop when he turned the boat off. Not quite like that. But he stopped the seas from being stormy. Yeah, I know. It was very scary. And then Jesus said, "Be still," and all the waves calmed down. And then he was with the disciples. So.
And the next boat.
Yeah, another big boat. It was.
It was really big.
It was a big boat.
It was a big boat.
tell you what, guys, how about we say a quick prayer and then you can go to class or back to mom and dad in the back? I'm not quite sure. But let's go ahead and pray. Can you pray for me? Lord God, thank you for being with us when we're scared. And thank you for helping us not be frightened when things are going a little bit crazy in our boats of our lives. In your name we pray. Amen. All right, thanks, guys. Thanks for coming up. Do we go to classroom or do we go back to mom and dad?
Classroom.
Classroom. All right, have fun, guys. Motorboat too. That sounds like fun. All right, well, I am not that young anymore, and I'm going to betray my age even more when I ask any of you remember the advice columnist Ann Landers. You remember Ann? Yep. She began writing Ask Ann Landers back in 1955 and continued writing that column for 47 years. She was named as one of the most influential women in the United States. And her twin sister, Abigail Van Ruin, also wrote an advice columnist. Now, one time, Ann Landers was asked if she got a prevailing kind of theme or topic that her readers would ask her for help. She didn't have to think long about it, but when she did respond, she said, yes, there was a dominant theme. And that theme was fear. What frightens us? Economic instability, political unrest, biological warfare or domestic terrorism, the death of a loved one being diagnosed with a debilitating disease, maybe it's the loss of a job or inadequate retirement savings. Maybe it's thinking about what church will be like when we enter into our new normal. Maybe what frightens us is what this church will be like after Cornelia retires and you have a new pastor. We've been living through a global pandemic and something simple as going to the grocery store can seem frightening. Now, in today's text, we read about the fear that Jesus' disciples experience as they are in a boat crossing the Sea of Galilee during a storm. Before we read, though, let's go ahead and enter in a time of prayer. Prepare our hearts, O God, to accept your word. Silence in us any voice but your own, so that we may be still and hear your voice. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. And now for our gospel reading this morning. It comes from Mark chapter 4, verses 35 through 41. And I'm sure you're all familiar with this particular passage. On that day, when the evening had come, he said to them, "Let us go across to the other side." And leaving the crowd behind, they took him with them in the boat, just as he was. Other boats were with him. And a great windstorm arose, and the waves beat into the boat, so that the boat was already being swamped. But he was in the stern, asleep on the cushion. And I woke him and said to him, "Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing?" He woke up and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, "Peace, be still." Then the wind ceased, and there was a dead calm. And he said to them, "Why are you afraid? Have you still no faith?" And they were filled with great awe and said to one another, "Who then is this, that even the wind and the sea obey him?" The word of God for the people of God. Now, geographically, the sea, or the Lake of Galilee, is about 13 miles long and 6 miles wide at its widest point. And that body of water is surrounded by hills and mountains that reach elevations of 2,000 feet in the west and 4,000 feet in the east. And every afternoon, when the east-west wind comes through the valley, all of this Mediterranean air comes through. And it starts to collide with the hot air of the desert basin, and it creates these really strong winds and frequent storms that swirl over the sea at the base of those eastern hills. Squalls could erupt any time. That's how it is now, and that's how it was then.
Now, symbolically, in the Old Testament, the sea was often used as a metaphor for danger, terror, or mystery. In Jewish and Greco-Roman mythology, storms were ruled by demons. I knew this would happen. Demons, gods, and sea monsters. Yahweh was seen as the Lord of nature. Only God had the power to control the stormy seas. Only God could quiet the wind. Now, the psalm that Pat read earlier this morning is a clear example of this kind of understanding of God's divine power over nature. I'm going to read part of it again for you this morning. Some went down to the sea in ships, doing business on the mighty waters. They saw the deeds of the Lord, his wondrous works in the deep. For he commanded and raised the stormy sea, which lifted up the waves. And they mounted up to heaven, and they went down to the depths, and their courage melted away in their calamity. They reeled and staggered like drunkards, and they were at their wits' end. And then they cried to the Lord in their distress, and he brought them out of their trouble. He made the storm be still, and the waves of the sea were hushed. And then they got glad because they had quiet, and he brought them to their desired haven. The boat that the disciples were caught in began to fill with water during this windstorm. Tossed back and forth, they began to fear for their lives, their courage and their own abilities beginning to melt away. Imagine that scene for just a moment. Water splaying across the stern, soaking their feet, spraying their face, feeling that sick pit in their stomach. Now, they understood the hazards of being caught in a storm like that. They had plenty of experience on the Sea of Galilee. But what they weren't accustomed to that day was having the possibility of having a passenger in the boat who could calm the waves and protect them from danger. Now, it is still early in Jesus' ministry, and so they wake him by calling Rabbi, teacher. Not realizing that there, asleep on a comfortable cushion, I would hope, there on the stern asleep was God. And now this sleeping passenger, this former carpenter, does things that were reserved to be done by God and God alone, ordering chaos, conquering death, promising life. The sleeping man was doing things that no man, awake or asleep, should be able to do. Now, he made the storms be still, and he made the waves quiet. He ordered chaos. He conquered death. He promised life. Things that only the divine God could do. Now, the disciples were aware of the psalm, and they understood that this power was divine power. And so this event becomes a moment of clarity, even despite the chaos of the storm. Clarity as to Jesus' true identity and power, and clarity as to the desperate need of the disciples and our own need for the calming, healing power that only Jesus can provide. Clarity and awareness of God's power, clarity, and awareness that Jesus wielded that power and yet was also human, sleeping inside a boat. Teacher, Rabbi, do you not care that we are perishing? The disciples cry out. Now, the Greek word for perish can also be translated as destroy. How many times in our own lives have we cried out to God for something similar? God, where are you? God, don't you care about me? I feel betrayed. I feel hurt. I feel alone and afraid, and I feel overcome by this storm and this destruction in my life. Please, God, wake up. Wake up. And Jesus does wake up.
He arose. He rebukes the winds and he commands the storm to still. Through the power of Jesus' words, the great storm is transformed into a great calm. Embodied in Jesus is the power of God's word. God spoke in the beginning and created life out of the voidless, formless void. And God speaks again, and his word became flesh. God's word can calm our deepest fears. And what the disciples recognized, and what we also should recognize, is that they were not alone in their boat. Despite their fear, they realized that they had not been cast away, that they would not perish that day, that God would not abandon them while they are experiencing that physical storm. And we too, friends, must recognize that God will never abandon us while we experience our storms in our life. Now that's an important nuance, is it not? We all experience storms in our life. In our personal life, in our congregational life, in our national and global life. We know that Christians don't get some kind of divine, cosmic, get-out-of-free-jail card. Even as followers of Christ, we suffer. We mourn, we grieve. There are real and frightening things in our life, and sometimes we feel as if we might perish, that our courage might melt away in the face of calamity. We absolutely experience violent storms, storms that erupt sometimes without warning, catching us unaware. Sometimes there are storms that we see in the distance, coming right at us, and we feel helpless to get out of the way. But you see, friends, the storms in our lives, they do not have dominion over us. They do not own us because we are not alone in our boat. Even when life seems completely out of control, we can trust that the living God is with us. The living God is with us. New Testament scholar James Boyce writes this: "One can continue to live in the world of fear and chaos, seeing oneself orphaned or alone without the power of God, living in a world controlled by the power of Satan or the demonic. Or one can be open to hearing the message and the promise of this Jesus, in whom we are told that the kingdom of God has come into our midst and now offers a whole new future for our world and for our lives. The line between these two worlds is thin and risky, but in between them stands the gift and power of the good news of God's Messiah, of Jesus. This is part of the gospel message, to have faith despite fear. To have faith despite fear. Jesus asked his disciples, why are you afraid? Have you still no faith? Friends, Jesus is calling us to faith. Not just to believe in his existence, not simply to intellectually agree that he existed, but to come to him and to trust in him. Faith begins when we realize that we are in need of salvation. We are not self-sufficient. As much as we'd like to think that we are not. By ourselves, we flounder. We need the Lord just like the ancient navigators needed the stars at sea. So let's invite Jesus into our boats. Let's invite Jesus into our lives. Let us hand over our fears to him so that he can conquer them. Like the disciples, we will experience that with him on board. And with him on board, there will be no shipwreck. Because this is God's strength, not ours, but God's. Turning to good everything that happens to us, even the bad. He brings serenity into our storms because with God, life never dies. We have an anchor. By his cross, we have been saved. And we have a rudder. By his cross, we have been redeemed. And we have a hope. By his cross, we have been healed and embraced so that nothing and no one can separate us from his love. By his life and by his ministry, Jesus taught his disciples and teaches us not to give in to fear. The invitation of Christ is an invitation to move out of a place of fear and into a place of faith. To move out of a sense of imprisonment, to move into a sense of freedom. To move out of a great storm and to move in to a great calm. When we begin to understand that we live in communion with God, no matter what the external circumstances, we can let go of the fear that lurks in the shadows and instead move into the light, the divine, precious light of our Savior, of our Messiah, of our Christ. The disciples stood in the boat, filled with great awe, and said to one another, "Who then is this, that even the wind and the sea obey him?" It's Jesus. Jesus who arose from his slumber. It's Jesus. Jesus who arose from his grave. It's Jesus. Jesus who embodies God's love, from which neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in creation will be able to separate us. It's Jesus. It's Jesus who stills the storm, who brings us out of our distress, who quiets our fear and brings us to our desired haven. Friends, it's Jesus. Let us pray. Living God, we can see that your hand has been guiding us. You know that like the sea, our lives are not always calm. They are rocked by change and rocked by storm. We thank you for being our anchor, our rudder, our hope, O God. Through your Holy Spirit, help us to know that you are in the boat with us and will never abandon us to the storms of life. In your glorious and holy name we pray. Now, friends, in your worship order, we don't have our prayers listed. So first, we're going to sing hymn number 8, Eternal Father, Strong to Save. And then we will go into a time of prayer, including the Lord's Prayer. So will you stand with me, please, now as we sing hymn number 8.
Thank you.
us suffers, we all suffer. When one of us experiences joy, we all experience joy. And so this morning, friends, I'd like to ask you, are there specific joys, specific concerns that you would like lifted up this morning? Any prayers that come up for you today? Yes?
A joy to have you here, Ariel.
Oh,
thank you so much.
Thank you. Any other joys? We have some birthdays, I know. Yes, David.
I'd like prayers for our neighbor, Peggy Patrick. She was diagnosed with terminal cancer 25 years ago, and she was given a year to live. She died last year after 25 years. We had her memorial yesterday, and it was just kind of magical. So it's over a year late, but I just want to celebrate the life of Peggy Patrick.
Well, my brother passed away back in New Jersey about a month ago, and then my sister passed away in Florida this past week.
Oh, sorry.
Oh,
what are your brother's
sister's
names?
My brother's Ted.
Jared?
Ted.
Ted.
And my sister is June.
June.
Yeah.
Ted and June.
Yeah. And they both were kind of ill for quite a while.
Let us pray. Good and gracious God, Lord of the church, Lord of all, our hearts are full of gratitude this morning for your generous, unconditional love. We thank you for the gift of life and its amazing diversity and variety, for the gift of our own lives and the lives of our dear ones. Give us comfort in our fear, knowing that you are always present with us. We are increasingly aware of the ways that we are blessed by your love and surrounded by your goodness. For the beauty of this day, for the beauty of the earth, and for the beauty of the lives that impact on our lives, we give you thanks and praise. May our awareness of your presence continue to grow as day by day we experience the power of your Holy Spirit moving through our lives and our actions. Empower us to say what we believe, to live what we profess, so that people everywhere will come to know your great love for them, O God, and enable us to know and celebrate that same love in our own lives in the days and weeks ahead. Almighty God, you have given us grace at this time to lift our voices in joyful praise and sincere prayer. You have also promised that your beloved Son to be in our midst when we gather in his name. And so today we lift up those mourning the deaths of Peggy Patrick following a battle with cancer. We pray that you surround Peggy, her friends, her family, in your love. And we know, Lord, that regardless of when our loved ones depart from this earth, there remains that grief. And so we ask you to fill that hole with your love. We pray for Ted and June, who also have passed away. We ask that you attend to their family members with your attentive care, and assure us all that we will be rejoined with our loved ones at some day, restored to health, where nothing can ever separate us from your love, ever. God, you know what is on our hearts, and so hear us now as we add our own silent prayers to you. We know and trust, God, that you are always with us, in cold and in warmth, in darkness and in light. In every season and in every moment of our lives, you promise to hold us in your loving embrace, and you promise that you will never, ever let us go. Trusting indeed that you are always there, we pray to you now as your Son taught us, praying together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, a reminder about our gifts and offerings, that we will continue to collect those in the offering plates by the door. So we thank you for your generosity, that we may continue to do this church's ministry and mission at all times. Let us stand together and sing our hymn number 291, Spirit of Gentleness, only verses 1 and 4. Receive now this benediction. God knows not only your name, but every hair on your head. So in all things be a mirror and reflect Christ's compassion, grace, love, and mercy to all. And all of God's children say together, Amen.
And I asked, I think the tree,